good morning, good morning. It's good to see everyone. We are doing an interjection sermon this Sunday. Next week, next Sunday, we're going to be starting a new series called Love Song, and it's about marriage and relationships and love, the month of love. I was born in February, the month of love. It's pretty awesome. Yeah, you're welcome for that information. We're going to be in Galatians chapter 5 this morning, and we're going to be talking about what it means to walk by the Spirit. And I don't know about you guys, but even after I became a Christian, there are some things that I still struggle with. I still fall short. I still make mistakes. I still do things that are wrong. And I don't know about you, but you probably struggle with the same thing. And we all have those struggles. And so we're going to look at the reason why we have those struggles, what those struggles mean to us, and then how do we overcome the sin in our life? How do we walk by the Spirit? As a little kid, I would always jump on the tiles, the colors, you know what I mean? As I would walk down a hallway, or I would try not to step on a crack, because if you step on a crack, what happens? I knew you guys would get that one. That's so great. But if you step on a crack, you break your mother's back. So I'd always try to jump on the off-colored tiles. Or if I would be like walking down a sidewalk, this is how messed up I am, I would just literally try not to step on any cracks. So even if the bricks, you know, were really small, I would tiptoe or whatever. And, you know, that's kind of how it is when we are trying to follow God, is that we're trying to avoid making mistakes and at the same time stepping on the things that we should step on. Another idea is like this, right? Walking through snow. You never want to be the first person to walk through snow, right? You always want to follow because it's easier. Your shoes and your socks don't get wet, and you can step in the tracks that have been prepared for you. And that's what the Holy Spirit is hoping to accomplish in our life, that as we step and follow Him, our lives will become better. They will become easier, in a sense. The Bible says that Jesus said, "My burden is easy, my yoke is light." The commandments of God are not burdensome. And so the reason why God has given us His Word is to enable us to become who we were created to be. And so that's what God wants to accomplish in our lives. But let me put out a disclaimer. There are different types of teachings in the Bible that talk about being saved. And you have to understand that there are really two terms for salvation. One has to deal with our justification, our position in Christ. The other has to deal with our sanctification, or our condition in Christ. And let me show you what I mean. If you are driving down the interstate and you have an accident and it's your fault, you have broken the law. But in that accident, right, you have become disabled or hurt or broken in some way, shape, or form. Maybe your legs got broke or you had a head injury. And so there are two entities that are going to be sent to the scene. One is going to be a police officer because the law's been broken, and the other is going to be an ambulance because people need to be healed, right? And so that's what God has done on the cross, is that by sending Jesus on the cross, He has sent Jesus to pay the penalty for our sin. In other words, instead of you going to the court to pay the fine or to be sentenced to jail, Christ has done that for you. But at the same time, God has sent somebody else to the scene, which is the EMT, because you're broken. Your body is broken, your mind is broken, your spirit is broken. And so God has sent us the Holy Spirit that we might find healing. So in one sense, as a Christian, we can stand before God totally guilt-free, totally free of punishment and condemnation, but yet God is working with us through our sin. And this is what we are talking about this morning. Not our justification, but our sanctification, the process of becoming more holy. So God doesn't supernaturally infuse you with perfection and the ability to not sin. God declares you guilt-free, and that's what we call imputed righteousness. Now, Christians are commanded to be holy, and we find this all throughout the Bible, right? Be holy, Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 3. Be perfect, Jesus said in Matthew 5. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Do not let sin reign in your mortal body. Abstain from every form of evil. Abhor what is evil and cling to what is good. And so all throughout the Bible, we find this standard, this line in the sand that we should all follow. But what's the problem? The problem is we mess up. The problem is we got this thing called flesh that constantly battles against who we want to be and what we want to do. And I think all of you feel that, don't you? You feel that tension. You want to do good, you want to do what's right, you want to follow God, but then you have these cravings, these desires, these lusts, these thoughts that constantly battle in your mind. And Paul talked about this in Romans chapter 7. And he says it's an inner struggle. He says, I want to do what is good, but I don't. And the things that I don't want to do, I end up doing. And he says, who is going to rescue me? Thanks be to God, Jesus Christ our Lord. And so let's talk about that inner struggle. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, Paul says this, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and the things like these of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now this is a long list, but by no means is it an exhaustive list. And Paul is basically saying, those who practice these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now he is writing to Christians here. And so we, even though we're standing before God justified, if we as Christians, the word practice means habit, lifestyle, regular practice. So if we as Christians live habitually in a life of sin, we will disinherit ourselves from the kingdom of God. That's why sanctification is so important. That although we can stand before God totally justified and free, we have work to do. And if we as Christians say, you know what, my sin's not that big of a deal. Yeah, I struggle with addiction to pornography. Yeah, I struggle with addictions to alcohol or to drugs. Yeah, I struggle with these certain addictions or I live this type of lifestyle. We can disinherit ourselves from the kingdom. And so let's go through this list here. The first one that he lists is immorality. This is the Greek word porneia. It's where we get the word pornography. It means adultery in an illicit relationship with a married person. Adultery is so detrimental because it ruins families. It alienates children from their parents. And the Bible very clearly says it will keep you out of heaven. The second word that he gives is impurity. This is fornication. It means an impure mixture. It's to be morally dirty, right? It's to have sex before your marriage is what he's talking about. And the Bible is very clear that those who practice fornication will not inherit the kingdom of God. The third one he gives is sensuality. It is an unbridled lust. And here's how I explain this, right? We all have natural desires and inclinations. Let me give you a perfect example. Me as a male heterosexual, I have natural inclinations and desires. Most people do, right? We all have sexual tension. Now, if a beautiful woman walks by and I say, oh, wow, she's really beautiful, right? That's natural. But if I say, oh, she's really beautiful, and I begin to play a story in my mind of lust, that's where sin enters the picture. And so the refusal to push stop on the movie in our minds is an unbridled lust. God wants us to conquer those things. So these could be dirty words, indecent bodily movements, sexuality that lacks restraint. And we see this all over television, music stars, in the movies. And for us to allow our minds to be infiltrated with this type of sin will break down our spirituality. The third one he lists is idolatry. It is simple as this. It is idol worship of a false god. It is a moral sin that can take priority in your life, an accomplishment or an achievement. And this is how I like to explain sin. Rather than law-breaking, which it is, it's really idolatry. You are placing this thing above God. And here's the thing. Let me give you a perfect example. Young men and women, if your body and it being perfect is your idol, right? You will do whatever you can to make that body perfect. And you will live your life being defined by the perfection of your body. And so when you mess up or you make a mistake, you feel empty, you feel depressed, you feel discouraged. Why? Because your body is your idol. How about a relationship? with somebody maybe that you want to marry, or maybe for those of you who are married. Your hope and your happiness and the definement of your life is now placed in another person. And when they mess up or make a mistake and they fall short, now you're sad, you're empty, you're broken, you're void, because sin is idolatry. Think about wealth or power or accomplishment or prestige. You live your life saying this: if only I can be greater, I will feel satisfied and whole. I will be what I want to be. And when you mess up or you make a mistake or you don't get the job you wanted or you don't have the retirement plan you planned for, you're broken, you're empty, you're destitute. And this is the danger of idolatry. And Paul says very clearly, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. How about sorcery? Now, this is a different one. Most of us don't practice sorcery in here. The Greek word for sorcery is pharmakos. What does that sound like of our English term? Pharmacy, right? Original witchcraft would be an attempt to contact the occult world through a pharmaceutical induction, right? So in other words, through taking drugs, you are attempting to empower yourself supernaturally or to cause certain events to occur through contacting the demonic world. That's originally what sorcery meant. That's why it is so dangerous to get drunk and to be intoxicated through different types of drugs, is because you are actually opening up yourself, your spirit, to demon possession. And so witchcraft is not the Lord of the Rings. Witchcraft is not the Chronicles of Narnia or Harry Potter. That is not witchcraft, okay? Real biblical witchcraft is things like the Ouija board, or saying Bloody Mary to a mirror in the dark, or doing summons or seances or curse tablets and things of that nature. That type of occult practice is very dangerous. You know, you can go to the toy store and you can get a Ouija board for your kids. It is completely and utterly demonic, and we should stay away from those things. Another word he gives is enmities. This is hostility or alienations or people who have their heart filled with hatred. Picture two people at constant war with each other. A lot of you are hitting your spouse. You're like, that's us. It's true, right? This is not supposed to be. Maybe parents and children, you're constantly butting heads. You're constantly at war. Not so in the kingdom of God. Another word he gives is strife. This is somebody who has a contentious spirit. They're always ready to argue. I mean, you can't talk about sports. You can't talk about Christianity. You can't talk about science. You can't talk about anything, and they always have to disagree or say, let me learn you something about this subject. Know-it-alls, constantly arguing, drives me insane. You know, we all know those people, right? And some of you are like, I'm that person. It's not good. People don't like you when you do that, okay? So stop. Strife, that's what it means to have strife. He says jealousy. This is the Greek word zealos. It's where we get the word to be zealous. It's to have an intense craving for what others have. And often we experience jealousy in forms of relationships. We can become possessive, especially in marriage or dating relationships. This person is mine. And whenever they don't do what I want them to do, I get angry. And so we can attempt to possess certain people in our relationships, and it's not good. It's rooted in a false teaching of self-promotion that I'm most important. How about this one? Outbursts of anger. These are fiery flashes of rage rooted in selfish ambition. It's something that slowly rises and then explode, right? This is what we call implosive people. An explosive person is somebody who just constantly just flips the switch all the time. But an implosive person is somebody who lets it build slowly. And then usually it's just the smallest thing, and then everything blows up. The Bible says you are not to live this type of lifestyle. How about disputes? These are rivalries, selfish ambitions, or factions. It's acting for one's own gain regardless of the chaos or division that it causes. It says, I want things this way because my wants are more important. He says dissensions. These are divisions or standing apart, and people typically split over things that really have no true value. Now, the Bible calls us to stay away from divisive people, people that are always having a problem with someone at some point in time. The Bible says stay away from those people, and that's something that we should do, right? You don't want a divisive person in your life, but really two Christians that are splitting over the color of the carpet or what type of pews that we have or the style of music, this is silliness. You will not inherit the kingdom of God if you nitpick over non-biblical issues. He says, envying. Now, envying is different than jealousies. Jealousy is intensely wanting what the other person has. And this is how sick it is to envy. It is to not only intensely want what the other person has, but it is the hope that they lose what they have. So picture a beautiful model, right? You not only want to look like him or her, but you hope that they have an accident to lose their beauty. Or maybe somebody has a beautiful voice and they can sing like me, you know, a beautiful voice. And it is the hope that you not only have a beautiful voice like Rick, but you hope somehow I lose my voice and I can no longer sing. Envying is jack up. You know what I mean? It's terrible. It really is a terrible thing. Drunkenness. A deep drinking or an intoxication. It is a state of losing your understanding, losing your ability to judge. It's like losing your balance. And here's the thing. If you are not morally and physically able to drive a car after drinking a certain set amount of alcohol, surely you are not capable to make moral decisions, right? And so the danger of intoxication and drunkenness is that it influences our decision-making ability. It influences our ability to morally reason. And so whatever threshold that is for you as an individual, the Bible is very clear. Do not get drunk. And even specifically, drunken parties, or what we call carousing. That's simply what it is. It's a drunken party. People get together and they drink. And usually when that happens, you have sexual immorality that takes place. And so these are simple drinking parties. You might have in your translation orgies, right? And this is something that the Christian church had to battle against in Corinth. And so he gives us this long list of things. And here's the thing. Every single person in this room struggles with something on this list. Here's the difference. Do you practice? Is it a habit? Is it something that you consistently do? Or are you fighting against it? Are you struggling against it? Maybe you struggle with looking at pornography. Maybe you struggle with drinking. Maybe you have that type of addictive nature. Maybe you're constantly jealous or you're always at odds with people. The difference is what do you want to do? And God's willing to work with those who say, I don't want to do this anymore and I struggle with it. Or I don't want to practice this anymore, but this is something I'm trying to work through. God loves us enough to work with us. But here's the problem. If we're not willing to confront these things and face them and try to fight against them, as Christians, we can do two things. The first thing that we can do is what's called quenching the spirit. It's like having a big bonfire, right? I like bonfires. They're cool. They're fun. Roasting marshmallows, having a great time, and then some creep comes up and throws water on it. And I'm like, what is wrong with you? Why would you do that? You know what I mean? Like, I was having such a good time, and you took this big bucket of water, and you extinguished the flame. That's what sin does to the Holy Spirit working in our life. Paul very clearly said this, do not quench the Spirit. It means don't suppress it. Don't stifle it. It literally means to say, Holy Spirit, stop influencing my life. I want to do this. And the Bible says if we continue to do that, we quench out his voice. We put the fire out. Think about the flame of love. You know what I mean? We're going to be talking about this next month. And when you are in love with someone, you want to spend time with them. You want to be around them. You want to buy stuff with them. I mean, you just want to be with them, right? And if you haven't experienced biblical love, it is incredibly amazing. It's not lust. It is love. And it is fun to be in love, right? But think about this. I was listening to a radio program, and this lady called in, and she's like, things were going so great with this guy. We had just started talking with each other. We were spending every day with each other. And then after I took a trip to Vegas, I came back, and everything stopped. He didn't call me. He didn't text me. I would text him and call him a bunch, and he just totally cut me off, and I just don't understand what I did that was wrong. Well, the guy was on the radio program too, right? People love drama, and I was listening to it, unfortunately. You know what I'm saying? But the guy called in, and he was on the phone, and he said she took a trip to Vegas and didn't even tell me. He said, furthermore, she was posting pictures online of being with this dude. Here we are spending a day together every day. She takes a trip to Vegas, doesn't let me know, and she posts pictures with this guy. I imagine she, you know, did things that she wasn't supposed to do. And she's like, yeah, well, but things weren't official. They were just going back and forth. I'm like, you guys are insane, right? But her sin and her miscommunication totally extinguished the flame of love in their life. He didn't want anything to do with her. And that's what sin can do to the Holy Spirit, is we can extinguish it to where we don't even want to read our Bible. don't even want to go to church. We don't even want to try to fight against our sin. Here's another word that the Bible gives for quenching the Spirit, and that is to grieve the Holy Spirit. Paul said in Ephesians 4:30, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." Now, there's nothing special about the word grieve here. That's literally what it means. It means to deeply grieve emotionally. That when we live a lifestyle of sin, it literally affects the heart of God. It's where we get our idea of to be sadness or to grieve at a funeral. God really feels when we sin. We are casting a different vote for a different universe. We are saying, "God, I choose this over you." It means to cause pain, to vex the heart, or deep sadness. Think about that. That when we sin, we cause grieving so intensely in God's heart that it's actually the same word as used of childbirth. That type of intense pain. And women, you can understand that. What you went through in bearing that child, the amount of pain that you endured, that's the same idea that it comes to mind when God grieves over our sin. Paul said in Colossians 3, "Consider yourself and your earthly body dead to immorality, impurity, passions, evil desires, greed," which amounts to what? Idolatry. And so for us to be confronted with our sins, to be challenged with walking in the Spirit, we've got to really think, what am I struggling with? What is keeping God's Spirit from working in my life and helping me grow towards Him? And sometimes it makes you angry, because let's face it, we love some of the things that we do. We enjoy it. We're passionate about it. These are things that bring us some form of gratification that's only temporary. But God is our creator. He knows what's best for us. He created us to live and function in a certain way. And so these sins that you enjoy, they're deceptive, because you have to keep filling up that tank. One drunkenness leads to another. One sexual act leads to another. Look, we all started, for those of you who have been addicted to porn, and I have been in the past, it starts with one look at a screen, and then all you want is more. That is the danger of sin, is that it always leaves you empty, and it never satisfies. So let's flip the script here and see what God wants us to do. So the key phrase that I would be focusing in on this morning is simply this, that in order to be set apart from the sin in our lives, we need to stop feeding the sinful flesh and start feeding the Holy Spirit. To stop feeding the sinful flesh and to start feeding the Holy Spirit. Some of you may know this illustration. A young boy was talking to his grandfather, and the grandfather says, "We all have two wolves inside, and they're constantly fighting each other. You have the dark wolf, which represents greed and anger and hatred and sin. And then you have the good wolf, the wolf of the light, which represents hope and purity and righteousness." And the little grandboy was sitting there thinking, and he asked his grandpa, he said, "Which one wins?" And grandpa says, "Whichever one you feed." And so if we are to overcome our sin, we have to feed the Holy Spirit. And there are 8 things that I want to give you this morning that you can do to feed the Holy Spirit. Here's number 1, information. Give yourself information from God's Word. One of my favorite passages of Scripture is in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And if you read that whole chapter, it talks about the law of Moses that brings death, and it talks about the Word of God, the Spirit, that we can look into that brings life. And the Bible literally says that when you read it, you are transformed into the glory of God. And so the only way that you can ever overcome your sin is to get the information in your mind. We read in Galatians 5, one of my favorite sayings that I have ever heard in a sermon, and I have memorized it, and I have practiced it in my mind, is simply this. If I am busy doing spiritual things, I won't be doing sinful things. If I'm busy doing spiritual things, I won't be doing sinful things. Well, the only way you can know to do spiritual things is to get that information in your mind. It's what we call the law of association. You become what you're associated with. The ancient Greeks actually thought, we really don't have an English equivalent of the word glory found in the New Testament. The Greek word is doxa, right? It means what you emanate, what permeates off of you. And the ancients believed that the law of association, if I were to spend time with you, I would start becoming like you, right? And so they thought that you emanated a certain aura or a certain personality or certain characteristics that began to be absorbed by the people around you. And so that's what God is saying here, is he's saying when you read the word, When you associate with me, you start to become like me. My glory starts to be taken in by you. And that's why it's really important for us to get the information in our mind. But here's the thing. It's a relational information. You see, I can intellectually know my wife, right? I can know the things that she likes and what she doesn't like. But to know her in a relationship, to love her, is the question. You see, many of us might know God, but we're not in love with God. And we could use this propositional language to define who God is and what he's like and who we are in Christ all day long. But the question is, are we in love with God? And he has given us his Holy Spirit that we might be in love with him. And so if you practice this law of association and you constantly study the word, you'll transform. Here's number two, to be aware. This is probably the one that we struggle with the most because life gets busy, doesn't it? Things get in the way, accidents happen. Man, when I stub my toe, which I've done 3 times this last week, what is the deal? It's my pinky toe. I don't get it. I'm not going to cut you off. You know what I'm saying? But I stub my toe, and man, that rage or just that, you just want to outburst. It is there, right? But to be aware in my mind, right, knows that when I stub my toe, I control myself because I'm aware. Or when I know people that upset me, to have that on the forefront of my mind, to be aware. The Jews would do this, right? They literally did what God told them to do. They took a little box, and they tied it around their head, and they put a little scroll inside, and they wrote scripture on it, and they put it there, and it would just be right there. Wouldn't that be weird? If we were all walking around with boxes on our head? But the point of that was to always remember the word of God. That it was right there on the forefront of our minds. And that's what Paul says to do. Keep this scripture in the awareness of the forefront of your mind. Look at Romans chapter 8 with me. In Romans chapter 8, Paul talks about this, and here's what he says. He says, starting in verse 5, "For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind is set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile towards God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God." We have to set our minds on Jesus. Here's number 3, is prayer. Being devoted to Christian prayer, to a community of prayer, when you associate yourself with God in prayer, you become like him. And the Bible says that in Romans chapter 8, and we're going to pass over this verse just for the sake of time, but the Spirit intercedes on behalf of us. And so it is our communication with God that we can become like him. Number 4, to overcome this sinful state in our lives, to feed the Spirit is to have desire. To really want to be rid of our sin. And sometimes you got to look at your heart and you got to say, heart, stop wanting this stuff. Start wanting what God wants and praying about that. God, help give me the desire to want what you want, to do what you want me to do. Desire is very, very important. Here's number 5 is surrender. And this may be a tough one for us. It's to acknowledge our weaknesses, acknowledge our failures, but more importantly, to acknowledge them to each other. And are we afraid? We're afraid to go to the preacher, myself, because some people think it's a superstar who's super spiritual, and he's like, you know, we pay him to be a Christian. You know what I mean? Like, look, I'm no different than you. I struggle just the same as you do. I have the same thoughts, same cravings, same desires. I struggle in this life just like the next person. I want to follow God, and I want to admit my weaknesses to him, but to each other. Number 6 is trust. We must really believe and trust that if we follow God's plan, this will happen. So try it out if you haven't yet, right? Belief in God is seeing God put a wheelbarrow across a 1,000-foot drop on this little tiny line and say, yeah, I believe God can do that again. He's already done it 1,000 times. Trust is getting in the wheelbarrow. And so trust God by doing what he commands. Here's number 7 is act. We talked about this last week. Being devoted to spiritual service. And you know, some people think all you have to do is read the Bible. You got a struggle? Well, I'll just read more scripture. You're struggling with this? I'll just read more scripture. That is not the case. The Bible was a tool, is an instrument. It is part of the plan. It is not the only plan. I think it's important for us to read James here, where James says, Don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourself. And then number 8, to feed the good wolf is to give thanks. Give thanks to God. And you know what? Maybe you've got nothing to be thankful for. But that's when you say, God, I thank you for the coming victory. I thank you for what you are doing in my life, working this out that I may know you more. And so, as I said before, we're concluding with this key phrase. If I'm busy doing spiritual things, I won't be doing sinful things. Be activated, following God. And so let's turn back to Galatians chapter 5, where he talked about this really confrontation of following the flesh, and you won't inherit the kingdom of God, but then there are new things that you get to do. There are new things that are set free. And check this out. These are the qualities that we should all be striving for. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, Paul goes on to say this, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit." The Greek word for fruit is in the singular. Some people are like, yeah, I'm not too good with that self-control thing. Or, you know what, I just have a short temper. I'm not good with this kindness thing, and I can do these other things, but that, nah, I'm really not too good on that. People just really annoy me. You know what I mean? No. The fruit of the Spirit, it's singular, which means all of these attributes the Christian should be producing in the same time and in the same quality. So let's walk down through those before we end here. How about love? The Greeks had like 4 different words for love, and they didn't really have this word in their common language in classical Greek, and so it formulated in the Bible to be agape love. It means to self-sacrifice. It's chosen by the will of the lover. It's not determined by the lovee. In other words, it's not based on what the other person does or doesn't do. It's based off of your act, your choice. And we're going to talk about that in our next series of what the Bible really means when people should love one another, specifically in relationships. How about joy? It's spontaneous. It's radiant. It's a happy response to life. It's the joy that the Spirit produces because it's not dependent upon circumstances. Wouldn't you just love to not be upset and have your life ruined because of a relationship or a job or money or stuff? Wouldn't that be so freeing? To not let your emotions be determined by circumstances. That is the joy of the Spirit. How about peace? You see, the Greek philosophers, they thought, here's literally what they thought. This is how jacked up they thought. To have peace meant to eliminate desire. It meant to have death to the emotion. It's the cessation of caring. It's the complete absence of depending on anyone else for happiness. That is miserality. Miserality, is that even a word? No, that is to be miserable. I created a new word. You got it. But Jesus says, I come to free you. I come to give you peace, right? Joy to the Lord, joy to the world, for the Lord has come. Let earth have peace. That's why Jesus came. How about patience? To be long-tempered. This is a tough one, right? Because people are knuckleheads, man. I mean, seriously, you can't go anywhere without someone doing something that could drive you literally nuts. We constantly can be agitated with people. Look, chewing with your mouth open for me, oh my goodness, it drives me insane. I have a family member that I married into, and when this person eats peanuts, okay, when this person eats peanuts, I have to leave the room. I literally have to leave the room. It is terrible, and this person loves peanuts, okay, loves peanuts. It drives me peanuts, drives me nuts. But to be long-tempered, to be slow to anger is what this means. It can be said that patience is the even temper that comes from a big heart. So it's not the, I'm going to sit here and endure this and suffer. That's not what it means, right? It literally means to be even-tempered. How about kindness? Kindness is not just a sweet disposition. In the English, we lose the word kindness, but the word kindness in the Greek, it simply meant this. It is a serving and productive trait. So you're not just having an emotional feeling, but it's an active thing. You are gracious and kind to other people. He says to be good, to have goodness. This is generosity that can't be earned. If kindness is shown to a sinful woman in repentance, goodness means to stand up against evil, to show goodness. And that's kind of a different spin on our idea of what goodness means. But that's what it meant to the original writer. How about faithfulness? It means this, to be loyal, to be dependable, to be trustworthy. So in other words, can God depend on you? That's the question. He says gentleness. This is the fruit of controlled power. The Greeks used this word of a stallion or a horse or a very powerful animal that was under control. We say meek now, and we really, by meek, we meant a little weak, feeble person. That's not what the original writers meant. They meant power under control. So you're really strong. You could do a lot of damage, right? You could do a lot of really cool things, but it's controlled. It's like a gracious watchdog, right? Or a watchdog, rather. Who's under the control of his master. To get bit by a dog would be a pretty terrible thing, and maybe you felt that. It is not good, right? That would hurt. But the dog is under control, has a lot of power, but it's under control. And then ninth and finally, he says this, self-control. It literally means to hold in a desire. And what are those three big desires? Materialism, sexuality, and power. To bring ourselves under the subjection of God, to control our pleasures. It is to be a man with a master. Your body is not going to determine what you do. If you struggle with diet, let the Holy Spirit work in your life to bring you under self-control. Beat your body into submission. Stomach, you're not going to tell me what to do. Right? What about sexuality? You're putting yourself under submission and under control. These images and this lust, it's not going to define me. How about marriage? When you fight, when you argue, when you're contentious, the other person is not going to be my master. They are not going to control me. And so the fruit of the Spirit are all of these qualities that God wants to work out in our life. And so here's the really cool thing, is that God wants to help you throughout this process that we call sanctification. I've given you this illustration over the last 4 weeks of running down a beach and jumping all in. And we used to swim a lot, and we would go to this lake called Lake Isabella. It was a really fun lake, and out in the middle of this lake would be this huge, like, floating, what do they call those, like, floating devices or whatever. They have big barrels underneath, and my sister, she was actually a really good swimmer, and I wasn't that great of a swimmer, and she would just swim out, and she would stand on the deck, and she would be like, come on out, Rick, come on out, and I'd be like, no, I can't go that far. And she's like, well, just, I'll help you. And I'm like, no, I can't go that far. You don't understand. And I'm like standing, like with my feet in the water. And because she's so far out, I refuse to even take steps into the water, right? I refuse to even progress. And it's like the Holy Spirit is standing out in the middle of the ocean, and he is saying, come out here and be with me. And we're saying, I can't go that far. You don't understand. I've got some really jacked up stuff in my mind and in my life. And the Holy Spirit comes to us, and he stands beside us, and he says, no, I will help you swim. I will help get you there. And you're like, I can't do it. Well, that's the point, isn't it? You can't do it on your own. God is willing to walk through us in our life as long as we're willing to feed the Holy Spirit. Sanctification is tough work. It is hard. But God is willing to do these hard things with us. And that's why the Lord's Supper is so incredible. It's because it reminds us that in our journey and our struggle and our fight to be better, we are saved. I mentioned justification at the beginning of this message, that we stand before God totally and utterly guilt-free, even though we look at ourselves and we're like, wow, I am such a mess. That's what the Lord's Supper reminds us of, that God has freely forgiven us. By grace, you have been saved. And Jesus broke that bread, which was his body, and he passed that cup, which is his blood. And he says, I want you to remember that this is the new covenant, which is my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sin. Thank God for Jesus. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth. Thank you for our community and our togetherness that we could come together and celebrate life and forgiveness. God, I pray that you will just help us get our minds off of our struggles in this moment, to not think about those things, but to remember that in spite of those things, you have saved us. In spite of those things, you have redeemed us. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to be the penalty for our sin, to pay our debt, to forgive us, and to do it because he loved us. So Father, I pray right now as we pass this communion that we'll all remember that Jesus is amazing and he's wonderful and we have a relationship with him and that we proclaim his death until he comes again. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.